So I think we can start. So today is the second part from the experimental neutrino physics lectures. So yesterday was an introduction about mainly the detection techniques and how do we see the neutrinos. Today I will focus more on really on the experimental results and with an overview first of, so I will focus on, with the entire lecture on oscillation measurements. And first, review of the milestone that managed to reach the discovery of this phenomenon, and then I will give an overview of the latest results about the three neutrino mixing oscillation, and then in the remaining part of the lecture, the hints that we had of possible sterile neutrino existence. Okay, starting with the. The milestone that enabled to reach the discovery of the oscillations. We start with the so-called Sorrel problem. So in some experiments started to look at the neutrino coming from the sun, and they had some prediction coming from the standard solar model about the flux that they should receive from the sun. And when they were starting to measure those processes, the neutrinos, and with looking at different processes, so in different also energy range with different technique, what they were observing was a clear deficit with respect to what was the expectation. So actually, what they observed that more or less 2/3 of the electron neutrino they were expecting were missing. And this is another plot showing more or less the same kind of results. You have the expectation here with the yellow and green, depending on which is the sources for the solar neutrino. And the different experiments were observed are the blue columns. So for example, the experiment with the chlorine radiochemical sources or supercamiocande and camiocande here, or other SAGE and GALAX with the gallium. In parallel, let's say, we had also some anomaly on the atmospheric neutrinos. And we were seeing yesterday the atmospheric neutrino came from the cascade decay from the pion. And so from the muon decay, so when we have a cosmic ray that enters in the atmosphere, and so we are looking at the decay that of the pion and of the muon, we know how many muon neutrino and electron neutrino we should expect, and they actually is 2 to 1, 2 muon neutrino and 1 electron neutrino. But when, for example, Camiocande, another experiment, IMB, was looking at the flux of the atmospheric neutrino, what they were observing, again, was a deficit with respect to the expectation. So these are what is plotted here is the ratio muon to E observed with respect to the simulation. And again, what they were missing is more or less half of the muon neutrino. And this is the conclusion in the paper from Camiocande in 1988, where they were saying that they couldn't explain this missing. One possible explanation were the oscillations. Going to the discovery, then we moved to 10 years later in 1998. This was part of the talk presented at the neutrino conference, where Supercamiocande actually proposed an explanation of the deficit that they were seeing. What the Supercamiocande, for example, is the detector that is sketched here. Here you have the Earth, so it's looking from the atmospheric neutrino that come from up of the going downward of the detector or going up, so they cross the Earth, and they try to look at the angular dependency of those neutrinos. And what they saw is that for example for the electron neutrino, independently of which was the direction that is on the x angle, they had results more or less in agreement with the Monte Carlo, while when they were looking at the muon neutrino, what they see was a clear deficit for the neutrino that was coming upward, so crossing all the Earth. And the explanation that they gave is that those neutrinos actually were having oscillation inside with the matter in the Earth, and that's why it was not observed the expected flux in the detector. We moved then to a couple of years later, in 2001, we had another experiment, SNOW, that was looking instead to solar neutrinos, and with different, and it was studying different processes, the charged current, electron scattering, and the neutral current. And what they were that they were observing is were different measurements. For example, if they were studying only charged current, the what they were observing is again a third of the expected electron neutrino missing. And something, and for example, the point in the previous plot that I was showing, the, one of the first slides from SNOW, is here. So you can see it's again showing this deficit with respect to the expectation from the theory. While if they were looking at the neutral current, their measurement was in agreement with the expectation from the theory. And the explanation was the differences that we were seeing also yesterday between the charged current and the neutral current. For the charging current, you have to produce the lepton, so you have a threshold in energy, and while for the neutral current, you are blind with respect to the oscillation, so everything that, all the neutrinos that interact are collected, let's say. And so in this way, you actually manage to detect the entire flux. And this was the explanation. This plot is probably the most famous one for SNOW, and show again the similar conclusion. So you have here the different channel that they were observing. The charged current is reddish band here. So on the axis you have the electron neutrino flux with respect to the muon and tau neutrinos. So if you look at the charged current, you are not sensible to muon and tau neutrinos. While if you look, for example, the elastic scattering, you have dependency and some sensitivity to muon and tau neutrinos. And when you look at the charged current, you have entire sensitivity. And you see that the three measurements are completely in agreement. So there is no problem. There's no problem on the charged current measurement. It's just that they only see a part of the flux. So with these two experiments, these two main results that I just presented, they are the clear discovery of the neutrino the oscillation phenomenon was assumed. And actually, this was a Nobel Prize was given to the spokesperson of these two main experiments in 2015. So if we look now at the PMNS matrix that we're also already seeing in the previous lectures, so we have here the three flavor states and here the three mass angel state, and you see the parameterization of the matrix with the three different blocks, and with I highlighted the experiment or the kind of experiment that can access those parameters. And so we have these two mass splitting. If we count the parameter that we have to measure, three mixing angles and the delta CP phase. Here again as the experiment, the kind of experiment that can perform those measurements, and this for example, the kind of signal that you looked at to measure those parameters. The current status of the knowledge of those parameters is summarized here. So here are the solar parameters, and here are the main experiments that actually contributed to those measurements concerning the so-called atmospheric parameters, so theta 2-3 and delta m squared 3-2, for example, Kamiokande, Super Kamiokande, or also now the current experiment T2K and NOVA are contributing to the measurement of those parameters. And then there is theta 1-3, and delta CP. So here are the measurements that you, the current status, for example, coming from one of the latest global fit where the theorists put together all the measurements from the different experiments. And so if we look more closely at what we know and what we do not know, the open question about this status of the oscillation parameter that are remaining are the question of the octant. So when we measure theta 2-3, actually we still have a range of valid angles, and we don't know actually if this angle is 45 degrees greater or lesser, and this actually has an impact on the oscillation. The other question is what we were already a bit discussing yesterday is about the mass hierarchy, so the sign of this delta m squared. and we will see how we can access to this measurement in the following slides. And the remaining question again is a CP violation. Do we have some CP violation in the electronic sector or not? And these are, for example, the current experiment that are trying to answer to those questions. If we look at the, so how do we explore this parameter? How can we measure those parameters with the experiment? Which are the signals that we want to, that we have to measure to access those parameters? Just a quick view. For example, if you look at, in the context of, accelerator-based experiment, to the disappearance, what you will have access is to the octant, so to the sign of the theta 2, 3. And, but this is, again, strictly connected to theta 1, 3. So it is not a clear signature. You will have to deal with the dependency to this other angle. If we look at for the, we look for the electron appearance, for example, what we have is the dependency of theta 1, 3. So this is how we access to this parameter to the accelerator-based experiment. We also have some dependency of on the octant. And but this is the channel that we have to look at if we want to search for CP violation. We also have some matter effects if the experiment is sensitive to. Instead, if we go to reactor-based experiment, we will have to we will look at the electron anti-neutrino electron disappearance, and this is a clear signature actually of the theta 1-3 angle with, without any dependencies, for example, of delta. And this is something that is that will be that is used, for example, by the experiment, as we will see later. So, how do we measure delta CP? There are a couple of strategies. So at the accelerator, delta CP is accessible only if we have experiment at the accelerator and not at the reactor. So the, in principle, the idea of the measurement is simple. You look at the deformation of the spectrum that you have in the neutrino and antineutrino oscillation. So for example, if delta CP is zero, you do expect that the oscillation will affect in the same way neutrino and antineutrino. If instead you have a delta CP that is different from zero, and to have a simple example, we take one of those, for example, minus pi over two, in this case, we will have an enhancement of the neutrino oscillation and a suppression of the antineutrino oscillation. This is represented here. So there are many lines and many colors, but we'll try to explain. The black line is when you have delta CP equal to zero. So in this case, we do not have any differences. If we look at, again, at delta minus pi over two, what we will have is an enhancement of the neutrino oscillation. So you see the blue curve is higher than the black one, and the in the for the antineutrino is a suppression, so it's lower. So yes, this kind of deformation of the expected spectrum is even more clear in the second maximum. In this figure, not, but I can assure you that this is the case, and actually the next generation of experiment are willing to have a flux that also cover this maximum, because in this case, this deformation of the spectrum in a neutrino-antineutrino mode is really even more clear, something like a factor of three, for example. We also have some matter effects, depending on how the experiment is, which is the baseline of the experiment. And so in this case, we will have to take into account also the matter effect that, as we will see, do something similar. The other way to detect it at 1-3 is to use an accelerator-based experiment that is not sensible to matter effects and actually constrain delta CP using the value of theta 1-3 measured at the reactor that we were seeing, that is a clean measurement, let's say. For the mass hierarchy, how do we measure them? Again, two strategies, one, let's say, based for the reactor, and the other one for the accelerator. Concerning the reactor, what they look like, so the probability for the anti-electron disappearance is what is written here, that it has a component on theta 1-3, but you also, depending on the baseline, if you are far enough, or let's say middle range, you are also sensitive to solar oscillation. And this is what is plotted here, for example. This is the flux that you would observe without oscillation, and this that is in black here or for example here in the zoom, is the flux that you would have, the spectrum that we would have in case of if you are sensible to solar oscillation. How they do investigate the hierarchy, actually what they do is try to disentangle between this wiggling that is here, that is generated in case of normal hierarchy or the inverted hierarchy. And why you have this effect that is actually estimated on the 3%, because depending on how do you in which order you are, or which hierarchy you are, this delta m squared 3-1 has a different size. And the differences in this case is of the order of 3%. So this is the way they want to investigate they will investigate the mass hierarchy in the other reactor. Concerning the accelerator, instead, we have some, if the long baseline is long enough, we will have some sensitivity to the matter effect that actually play a different role if you are in a neutrino mode, or so you have neutrino, or if you have antineutrinos. And again, this is what is shown here. If we consider a delta CP equal to zero, for example, and so you will have matter effects that will enhance the oscillation for the neutrino and suppress, enhance the oscillation for the neutrino in the normal hierarchy, and we actually will enhance the oscillation for the antineutrino in the inverted hierarchy. So this is the game that we have to look at. How do this actually is shown, which is the effect really on our measurement? So this is a small series of plots that try to show you how you would have your measurement in different assumptions. So for example, if you look at the probability of having, let's say, an appearance of electron neutrino or in the neutrino mode or in antineutrino mode, if you have no matter effect, no CP violation, and you consider, for example, for simplicity, a maximal mixing, you will have exactly the same probability. So the two oscillations will play in the same way. Instead, if you allow to have some matter effect, you will have that your measurement actually will shift up or down depending on if you are in the inverted mass ordering or the normal mass ordering. And if you allow for CP violation, depending on the value of the CP that you have, your measurement will move around in an ellipse. And finally, if you allow to have some degeneracy because you don't know which is the octant that you have, so which is the measurement of this theta 2-3 angle, you will have the shifting on the other diagonal. So you will have this your measurement that can be sitting here or here, depending on which is the value of this angle. Okay, so this is just for the overview. So which are, in general, the analogy strategy for the experiment? The estimation of the flux, so how many neutrinos the detector receives for the oscillation measurement is crucial, but it's also difficult, both for the reactor and for the accelerator. So one the idea is to have two detectors in general, so one near detector that would measure the flux of the neutrino before any oscillation, and then the far detector, where actually you will measure the neutrino after the distortion due to the oscillation. And again, depending on where you put where you put your far detector, you may be sensitive to different oscillation parameter. For example, for the reactor experiment, if you have a short baseline of the order of 10 kilometer, what you will see is sensitivity to theta 1-3, while if you put your far detector at a farther distance of the order of 100 kilometer, what you will have is the sensitivity to the solar parameter. Okay, I now start a review of the recent measurements, starting from the reactor. So we have three main experiments running now and providing nice measurement of this theta 1-3 angle. Actually, the first measurement arrived in 2012, the same year of the Higgs. So these are the characteristics of these three experiments. There is Here you have, for example, the power of the nuclear power plant they are looking at. Here are the information about the near detector with the baseline that they have here, and the composition. So one near detector for Double Show, one near for Reno, and actually two sites near for Daya Bay with two detectors each, and also the mass of that they have, and the baseline for the far detector for the three cases. And you can see, for example, Daya Bay in the far detector has four detectors, so it's really an impressive experiment. So looking at Daya Bay, that was actually the first experiment measuring this Theta-1-3 in March 2012. So this is a sketch of the sites. You have the different location of, so these are the two near sites, and this is the far site. Here are the nuclear power plant, and this was this is the detector that we were discussing yesterday. This is the picture of the far holes, where you can see the four detectors that are here. And this was actually the measurement that they were published in 2012, where you can see actually the depth, so the deficit of neutrino at the far location when, with respect to the expectation. That was the signature of the disappearance, and then the measurement that they were performing for Theta-1-3. So they were measuring actually Theta-1-3 different from zero with a significance of 5.2. And it was really an impressive measurement. And they continue to update the measurement. And the latest results, it is here, presented recently also here at CERN. So this one, for example, is the spectrum of the prompt energy that has a real connection to the neutrino energy. So in blue, you have the spectrum in the case of non-oscillation, and the black point are when you have, these are your data. And see, if you do the ratio of the two, what you have is the clear signature of the disappearance. So if you measure the position of the depth, you can really extract the measurement of the angle and of the frequency of the delta M, and that you can plot, that is plotted here, and so you can extract your measurement. What is impressive is that even if they have a very high statistics due to the intense flux that they have from the reactors and the amount of detector that they have, their measurement, even if that is very precise, is still statistically dominated. Then there is the other two reactor experiments quickly. So there is Reno that the measurement is here. And here you can see, for example, the comparison with Daya Bay and Double Show, previous measurement. And Double Show, the most recent results that was presented here at CERN using the near and the far detector, that was the first time that we were providing this measurement. And again, you can see, for example, here the differences, the deficit that they observe at the far detector with respect to the near. And these are the value that they extract. And so if you compare all the measurement together from the reactor, this is the different measurement performed by the experiment, and also depending on which is the target, let's say, for the neutron capture, so the gadolinium, the hydrogen, and you see the very precise measurements from Daya Bay, and they compare it with all the others that are in more or less all in agreement. There is a deviation from Double Show of about 2 sigma, but we will see in the future if this is significant or not. You also have here in the table the measurement from T2K and Minos, as we have seen. That are also sensitive to the Theta-1-3 angle. Okay, moving now to the accelerator-based experiment. I'll start with Minos and Minos Plus. So Minos and Minos Plus are experiment in the US. Actually, Minos Plus shut down in 2016. They had a baseline of about 700 kilometers, so pretty long, and with an mean energy, average energy of the neutrino higher than the GeV, so 2 GeV at the beginning, and then 6 and 7 for Minos Plus. This is a summary of the data taken. They were taking data in both neutrino and antineutrino mode. This is a spectrum that they were observing. And another thing is that, for example, the beam power that they were receiving at the end that was increasing. And this is another very challenging point for the different experiment along baseline, because this gives you the amount of statistics that you will collect and how fast. The latest results they have published about the muon disappearance, so the measurement of the theta 2-3 angle and delta M32. So here you see the nice signature of the muon disappearance, so that is given by the ratio between the measured flux of neutrino of the fire detector with respect to the expectation in case of non-oscillation, and you see clearly the depth, and measuring again the position of this depth, you can extract information about the mixing angle and the delta square 3-2. Another experiment that is performing this kind of measurements is T2K. This is an experiment in Japan. It started in 2010 and is still taking data. The baseline this time is 300 kilometers, so it's shorter than almost half of what was for MINOS. This is the first experiment that was using the off-axis technique that I was explaining yesterday. So the fact that putting your detector off-axis, you actually have a narrow-banded beam and pick it at given energy that is of a, more or less of 0.6 GeV. There are data collected in both neutrino and antineutrino mode, and they're using a kinematical approach. So they base their measurement actually on the reconstruction, for example, of the lepton that came out from the charged current. This is the summary of the data taking that, again, is increasing, and the beam power that has been reached so far, for example, 450 kilowatts, a bit lower than for NUMMI. The measurement, so here are the spectrum at the fire detector for the different neutrino and the antineutrino. So here, when we look at the muon neutrino, so they collected 132 events, for example, and you see in blue the expected spectrum in case of non-oscillation, while the data point are far below. And so when you do the ratio, again, you have the signature of the deficit, and you can extract the measurement about theta 2-3 and theta 1-3. Similarly, you can do it in the antineutrino mode. The statistics is different because of many reasons. The data taking is more or less now similar, but it's more difficult to have antineutrino because of the cross-section, because also of the contamination of the beam, so you end up to have a lower statistics. But again, you can extract your measurements. And this is for the apparent channels, so when you look for electron appearance from the muon neutrino beam. And in the neutrino mode, there are 32 events. You see here the distribution of the data point that clearly show an excess, while the blue line actually show you the expectation in case of non-oscillation, and this is mainly driven by the contamination of the neutrino that you have, the electron neutrino that you have in your beam. And here, similarly for the antineutrino mode, and you see you only have something like 4 events. But anyhow, we can extract measurements. As we were seeing before, all the parameters in the accelerator-based experiment are correlated the one to the other. So those kind of measures are complicated. You have to take into account all the parameters together, so the fits are complicated. And this, for example, is the latest results for the theta 2-3 or theta 2-3 bar, depending if you are neutrino or antineutrino. And this is for the delta M square. And you see the comparison, for example, for the neutrino runs and the antineutrino runs, mainly dominated by the different statistics that was collected in the two mode. And T2K is actually leading the measurement on theta 2-3, actually. From the appearance channel, what we can extract then is the measurement of theta 1-3 but this is correlated to theta 1,3, and so these are the measurements that are plotted here. You see the angle, the mixing angle theta 1,3, and this, the different value that theta CP can have, and with the two curves for the normal or inverted ordering. But if you remind the, what I was explaining on the strategy for extracting delta CP, T2K is a short baseline, so it's not really sensitive to the matter effect. And you can also extract the delta CP value using constraint on theta 1,3 from the reactor. And the value of theta 1,3 is what is plotted here from the PDG from 2015. So if you put a constraint, an additional constraint, on the data that you are collecting and from your experiment, and this constraint coming from this reactor, you actually can constrain much more the delta CP, and this is what you are saying. You actually start to have some exclusion from different from different value for delta CP, and so what is allowed so far for the 90% confidence level is the dashed region here in black for the normal ordering and in yellow for the inverted ordering, and there is a preferences for both cases of the ordering of a negative value of delta CP close to minus pi over 2. These results are not conclusive, so it's just hints of which possible value we can have for delta CP, and we will see probably with the next generation of experiment how if delta CP is really different from zero and which will be the value. Another experiment that is actually started recently but is going very fast. It's a NOVA, again on the US, with a long baseline to 800 kilometers and a flux of neutrinos that is around 2 GeV. This time there is an approach that is different, a calorimetric approach, so they measure all the visible energy to deduce which is the energy of the neutrino that was interacting. For the moment, they collected the only data on in the neutrino mode, but they just, I think in this month or a couple of weeks ago, they started to take the data in antineutrino mode. So also for them, there will be a possibility to start to investigate even further the delta CP measurements. The results that are recently they were recently publishing is here, for example, for the muon disappearance. So again, the ratio of the expected spectrum in case of non-oscillation and the measured one. So this is that gives you this depth. And when you extract the parameters, you have this kind of contour. So with a recent measurement, they allowed actually two regions. And apparently, they are excluding a value of the maximal mixing at 2.5 sigma. This is a measurement. And again, we will see in the future how this is this compare. This is for the electron neutrino appearance. So this is the signature of the appearance for different different bin actors in the data selection that they have. And this is how they extract information for delta CP. For example, the number of events they observe is this 33 with the error band. And they look at how many events they would observe, they would expect in case of normal hierarchy and instead or in case of an inverted hierarchy. And you have the comparison. And there are maybe some values that are possible, it seems to be excluded, and so preferred value that again are looking at in agreement to the hints that came from, for example, from T2K. If we do some comparison, and we put together all the measurements that we have for theta 2,3 and delta M3,2, I put it here a couple of plots because in this one there are no latest result from NOVA that instead are included here, and also for ice cube that is this curve here. in this case is older. But you see how the measurement compares. So there are the Minos, T2K, and NOVA that I presented here. I didn't talk about SuperK and IceCube. But you see that there are very good superposition. So almost all the experiments are in agreement. There are something that we will see in the future about the clear measurement of theta 2-3, if it's maximal or if instead higher or lower. This is something that only with the more data taken will be discovered. Okay, so what's the future for the accelerator and reactor experiment? For the reactor, there is a foreseen experiment that is Juno, that is a really wide program in physics that is trying to be summarized here. So you have the visible energy and the spectrum and the deformation that we will have and what they plan to observe. So for example, looking at the lower part of the spectrum, they can investigate the solar oscillation. With the middle part, let's say, they can investigate the atmospheric oscillation. And also with the wiggling here, they expect to investigate the mass hierarchy in the way that I was explaining before. The data taking is foreseen for more the 2020, so in 2-3 years. And this is a detector that they plan to have, so with a liquid scintillator and the photosensor that with the PMT that will look at the signals. For the accelerator based experiment, there are two proposed experiments that are really complementary. There is DUNE that is foreseen for the US with a MIM neutrino from Fermilab to the South Dakota with a baseline of 1,300 kilometers. And there is Hape-Kamakande in Japan with a baseline of 300 kilometers, more or less a successor of T2K, and the energy that is still the one from T2K. Here they are using, they will use Cherenkov detection, as in Super-Kamakande, but with bigger detector and two. And in at DUNE instead, we will have liquid argon TPC. Actually, four modules we were seeing yesterday of more or less 10 kiloton each of active mass. So the strategies are really complementary. DUNE will have some calorimetric approach for the analysis, and Hape-Kamakande on a kinematical one. Hape-Kamakande is also thinking to have a second detector, maybe in Korea, and this will enhance the sensitivity for the mass hierarchy and also for delta CP, for example. And these are the comparison. These are the spectrum in gray that is expected for DUNE. That is a wide spectrum. Another difference that I didn't mention, DUNE will be on axis. Hape-Kamakande is still off axis. So you see the differences in the spectrum that they will expect. And the other thing is since DUNE has a wide spectrum, they do expect to be sensitive to this second maximum, where the differences generated by the delta CP will be more visible, and why, for example, for Hape-Kamakande will not be be the case, unless they have this second detector in Korea. These are the plots that summarize the sensitivity for CP and mass ordering, so CP here and mass ordering here. I will not go through. If you are interested, we can talk a little bit about this later. Okay, so this is for the first part, so for the three neutrino mixing, for the active neutrino, let's say. But what we knew is that from measurement, for example, at LEP, is measuring the invisible width of the Z boson, we do expect three neutrinos. And if we consider to have more than three neutrinos, any other neutrino would have to be sterile, in the sense that would not have to couple with a Z, and the only way to see it would be towards the its mixing to the active neutrino. So this is the meaning of the sterile. Why are we talking about possibility of having sterile neutrino? Because in the 90s, for example, the LSND experiment was with a baseline, so it's an accelerated Bayes experiment with actually a beam of stopping pion and stopping muon with a short baseline, 30 MeV. So that gives you an L over E of about meter over MeV. Was observing actually an excess in the antineutrino mu to antineutrino E that is represented here. So you see the data point actually that are clearly over the expectation that they have. And this signal actually was compatible with the hypothesis of having an oscillation with a delta N square or the order of 0.2 square electron volt. In more or less in the same here, there was a Carmen. That is another experiment with a similar L over E. Also similar in the detector, but it was not observing any excess on the same channel that LSND. And in the Bouguer, in a reactor-based experiment, was also trying to look at oscillation measurement. In this way, in this case, since the reactor is the antineutrino, anti-electron neutrino disappearance, with also the different baseline, and they wasn't observing any excess either. So this, for example, is a summary of the measurements with the mixing angle at delta M square. So the blue is what the region that is foreseen for LSND, where the LSND was expecting some signal, can expect some signal from oscillation. And the other curves are, for example, Carmen and Bouguer in green, that are the exclusion, that already excluded some region of this phase space plot. So The signal that was seen by LSND, actually, since we were measuring the other delta M square from the solar and the atmospheric, and we were considering that could be explained by a delta M square of the order electron volt, the only way to explain this was to introduce a fourth neutrino, because this delta N square is much bigger than the other two, so that there is no possibility to have a confusion. The other two are of the order of 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 5, so a square electron volt, so it's really something different. And the only way to try to explain this mass splitting much higher than the other was to introduce another neutrino. And for that, for the measurement that we had, the constraint of the number of neutrinos that we have, for example, at LEP, we were considering as sterile. So this, for example, is the chart of the mass splitting. So you see the solar one of 10 to the minus 5, or the other of 10 to the minus 5, the atmospheric of 10 to the minus 3, and the another one that would be of the order of 1 electron volt, much higher, or actually much lower. So depending on how there are different models for sterile neutrino, they try to accommodate the anomaly that I will also will present in the next slides. And so 3 plus 1, 1 plus 3, depending on how do you arrange this delta M square, or more than 2, or for example. And what I will talk about late in the following slide, the results are based on the 3 plus 1 model, that is the simplest one. So just some small math to express the oscillation probability. So since this mass splitting is much higher than the other two, we can, for simplicity, consider the two other mass splitting as degenerate, and so use, for example, the two neutrino flavor approximation. And so if you write down the appearance or the disappearance probability, it can be written with this simple expression. And then here you have the relationship between this mixing angle and the element of the unitary matrix that has been extended to consider a fourth neutrino as sterile. And so this will be for the neutrino, for the electron neutrino disappearance, for the electron, for the muon neutrino disappearance, and the relation for the appearance. Which are the results? So, we had in 2000 Mini Boon an experiment, a long baseline experiment with a baseline of 500 meters. And again, this L over E of similar to what was for LSND and for Carmen, that was a design explicitly to address the LSND anomaly. And what the mini boom saw was the, an excess for both the neutrino channel and the antineutrino channel, and what is represented here. So here you have the spectrum for the energy, neutrino energy for the neutrino and the antineutrino mode, and you see that the data points are higher than the expectation. So the results, the final result from mini boom, both in neutrino mode and antineutrino mode, were compatible to the LSND with maybe some marginal compatibility. But again, they were not conclusive as they were supposed to be, but still not a clear exclusion. We also had some exclusion from Icarus, for example. Then in 2011, we had also some recalculation of the flux expected at the reactor. And see, this is the summary of the new calculation that is in blue with respect to the previous one. And what was observed is that this new calculation actually was expecting a higher flux. So with this new calculation, we were expecting a higher flux at the reactor. And so if all the measurement, rechecking all the measurement at the reactor experiment, they were all below. And so there was a signal of a clear deficit for the reactor experiment. This is what is called the reactor anomaly. And then some other hints of something that is about some anomaly for the three-neutrino mixing reported by solar experiment that are Galles and Sage. These are were doing some calibration of their detector using some radioactive sources. And they were detecting that the neutrino is exactly as they do for the solar for the solar neutrino detection. And what they were reporting is that the observed number of neutrino detected with respect to the expectation were lower. And again, so the deficit that we're detecting was about something like three sigma. So this is another hint of something that it was not expected by the three neutrino mixing. And so if we do a summary of all these disappearance measurements, for example, we have this region that is what the reactor allows, so some hints of possible that can be explained by a possible sterile neutrino, similarly for the gallium that they were observing the deficit. But we also have some experiment that they were not seeing any anomalies. And so again, the situation is not clear in this channel. And if we do a summary of the anomalies that have been reported so far, there were some anomalies on the appearance channel, like, for example, mini boom, LSND, and LSND. Some hints of in the disappearance channels that I just shown. But if you remind about the expression of the different angles that we have, and you look at how do we write down, for example, the angle for the appearance, you see that there is a clear dependency on the disappearance channels. So to have the appearance, actually, you need both the Nui disappearance and Numu disappearance with the same kind of mass splitting. And so what are the results for the Numu disappearance? Because we saw that we have some hints of the appearance, some hints of the appearance, and what is missing, for example, is hints on Numu disappearance. And the status is here. So this is already a general summary of the results from this experiment. Again, there are two plots with the latest results. There is some overlapping. So, for example, this is the exclusion curve that we have from Cyboon and Miniboon that is plotted also here. So this is the reference, for example. But what is clear from these two these two plots is that there is no sign in the Numu disappearance of possible sterile oscillation. So the disappearance, for the moment, the Numu disappearance just provide the Numu disappearance searches just provide exclusion curves, more or less extended in the parameter phase space. But this is the main message. And again, if we look, if you remember about the composition of the combination that or the dependencies actually that we have of the appearance angle with respect to the disappearance, what we can extract from the previous measurement is also further limits on the or further measurement on the appearance channel. So, for example, we can use the latest result from Daya Bay, looking at the Nui disappearance, and the latest result, for example, from Minos, that are the most extended one for the Numu disappearance, and combine those, we can have some other limits on the on the electron appearance, and this is what is plotted here. And if you compare the different curves, for example, for LSND is the light blue zone here, you can see that this combination of Minos and Daya Bay, actually there is also Bouguer that is included in this combination, almost rule out all this part at the low delta M square, and there are some investigations that still have to be done higher. So there is still things to do. The measurements are not conclusive. So again, what's next for the accelerator? There is a program in the US at Fermilab that is the SBND program. At, this is the sketch of the program. We will have three detectors, all based on liquid argon TPC. So there will be a near detector that is SBND, located at about 100 meters. Then will be a microboon in a middle position of about 500 meters, and then Icarus of at 600 meters. And the purpose of this program is to have a definitive measurement about the about the appearance. This is the sensitivity expected by the combination of the measurement at these three different sites on the phase space, so theta mu e and delta m square. Again, these are the allowed region for example, from Miniboon that are shown here. And you can see the sensitivity expected for this SBND will be able to explore all this region and so to confirm or reject the Miniboon measurements. From the other side, from the reactor, we also are waiting for conclusive measurements. There is a new strategy for the reactor experiment to look at the steriles, is to use very short baselines. And actually, very short baseline means something of the order of the meters. And what they want to do is to have a measurement that is independent by the flux estimation that we have seen that has changed recently, so it may be sensible to the anomaly or not. So in the way that we will have an extended detector, and that what they want to look at is the signal that they have in a different position of the detector. So they will use extended detector with some segmentation and looking at the signal that they have a different position. And actually, there is a pretty high number of experiments that is using this kind of strategy. I will not go through this table. This is taken by the conference in Neutrino in London this summer. And some of those experiments are already running, so we hope to have some measurements soon and have a more clear picture of the steriles. And I conclude. So in this latest year, we really had a breakthrough in the neutrino physics, thanks to a discovery of the oscillation. We have acquired an impressive knowledge about those oscillations in just 20 years. And the next generation of the experiment will continue to improve those knowledge and hopefully actually to have definitive measurement of and definitive answer to the remaining open question. From the other side, let's say for the sterile, we have some viral anomalies that have been reported by experiment to the three neutrino mixing paradigm. And we have some measurements that are contradictory. And so we are really looking forward for both accelerator-based and reactor-based new generation of experiment to have to clear up the picture concerning the sterile. And that's all. Thanks. Any questions? Yes.
Perhaps it is worthwhile to add two comments to your discussion on sterile neutrinos. The first one, there's considerable discussion on the shape, on the flux of reactor and the neutrino spectra. I just remind you of the 5 MeV bump, which has not been predicted by anybody, but is now experimentally established.
Yes.
There's no reason just to take this as Z flux and to deduce sterile neutrinos from it. So one question, this was one comment. The second one, the beginning of all this was the LSND experiment. You mentioned it, but you did not mention that there are two publications in Physical Review D which appeared after the experiment, which show in a convincing way that LSND is simply wrong. It is wrong for two reasons. The first reason, they used in their flux prediction data, which by later experiments were proven wrong. Second, they did straightforward mistakes in their data analysis.
Okay, but we still have the mini boom measurement that
yes,
have some.
Yes, but when you look at the mini boom, they did largely the same types of mistakes, which is not very surprising because the mini boom collaboration consisted more than half of LSND.
Okay, we will see in the future about the definitive measurements.
Of course, this has to be clarified experimentally, but when presenting such so-called evidence, one should present the full evidence and not just half of it.
Okay. Yes.
So actually, I still hope that the sterile neutrinos will pop out because that would be sensational. But anyway, a question I have is for the Juno experiment. They're going to do the mass hierarchy and they will probably start taking data already in the beginning of the 2020s or so. So how well would they be able to do if you think of T2K running, but particularly then Dune and Hyper-K coming. So you have some quantitative idea of how well they could establish the mass hierarchy?
How well you mean the precision? I don't have the, I don't remember.
Like 3 sigma in the most favorable scenario?
No. I think they will go even higher than the 3 sigma. I don't have the. Sorry, I was reading this when preparing the talk, and I don't have it in mind. I will check it. And the measurement is very challenging because of the resolution in energy that they have to have. So there is a really enormous work that they are doing to achieve this energy resolution. Then the projection that they do, I'm sorry, I don't remember. I have to recheck. Any other questions? Sorry, I was thinking to the answer for this because. No? Okay, thank you.